Spikes Car Radio starts now.
But long as there are stars above you,
what better song?
You never need to doubt it.
For summer.
I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be.
You like this song, Jonny? Listen to this song. Like forget it. Don't even. Don't ruin it if you don't.
If you should ever
majestic, achingly
me,
beautiful.
Who's this?
Who is it? It's the Beach Boys.
Oh, no, I don't like this.
Just okay, I'm turning your mic off. This song, Paul McCartney, called possibly the greatest song ever written, Jonny. The greatest song ever written. And when I hear it, I think of, listen. It's a little complex. Listen to this. Just the instrumentals. 20 takes. They did 20 takes. Before the winning take, Brian Wilson said, one good strong take and we've got it. Let's play it strong. They played this version without the vocals. Here was the only note. Move the flutes closer.
Yeah.
And that session ended at
4:30
in the morning. And they created this masterpiece.
Not my cup of tea. However,
it makes you want to write a movie, doesn't it?
However, it makes me advise everyone to read the Heroes and Villains book, the Beach Boys biography.
Yeah.
They are the most twisted people who wrote the most saccharine sweet nonsense Christmas shopping music, like that song. But the book is insane. These people are like mental, the whole family.
Yeah, yeah.
Top to bottom. It's a wild, fun book.
I put the Beach Boys on when I have the top off my Bronco and I drive out to Malibu. And life is pretty damn good for 20 minutes. It's like the Massachusetts kid in me is like, I did it. I did it. I'm here. I'm in the place where Annette Funicello was making movies. I'm in that place. Rockford Files. I'm here. I'm on that road. I'm listening to that music. I'm living that life. I've achieved this dream of 8-year-old Spike Ferriston.
See, I grew up on the other side of Malibu. I grew up in Thousand Oaks. So it's, you know, one canyon
That's
away.
That's disappointing.
And yeah, I was like, it does nothing for me. Hmm. But anyways, how you doing?
Welcome to Spike's Car Radio, ladies and gentlemen. Debbie Downer and Spike Ferriston are here. Stamping all of most folks aren't here in California, so you want to paint that picture for them and this dream.
Keep them away. You know how everyone's like, oh, everyone's leaving California. I'm like, get out, go. How can I help? Where can I pack? I have a truck. I can move stuff for you.
I'll tell you who left California. Zuckerman left California. We're going to call him in a little bit. He's in with the memory people at the nursing home.
Mm-hmm.
This could be the time they have the intervention and they tell him, you're living here. He's that old.
Isn't he 1 month younger than you?
I'm going to visit my mom. Not really, but it was nice knowing you. Leave the keys to the GT3 RS with me, please.
Yeah, aren't they right here?
Why? They've got a wheelchair for you with blue wheels. I made it myself.
It's PTS wheels.
And also calling in from London, from the set of House of the Dragon, Ryan Condal, the showrunner of and co-creator of the Game of Thrones prequel, House of the Dragon. Their upcoming season launches June 16th. Oh, next week.
Coming up.
And he's a Porsche guy and he's on one of my favorite shows. So I said, yeah, come on the show. We'll chat. Nice. We had a nice chat. We'll play it back. And I think, though, right off the bat, I think we have to jump right into the new 992. That's the thing that came out the day we posted last week's show. We didn't have a chance to address it. You're the perfect guy to address it. There's lots of big news there. I thought it was interesting, though, they led with the GTS as opposed to the just Coupe 992. Why is that? Just the special nature of the hybrid engine?
It's interesting. So, you know, normally when they launch, the last couple launches, when they launch a new 911, they do the Carrera and the Carrera S, right? It's always the S and the base car. And this time they're skipping the S for whatever reason. I think it's just that they did a lot
skipping
of...
Skipping it in what sense?
They'll be in a couple months, 6 months after the launch of the...
Oh, they didn't announce it then.
They haven't even announced it's going to be a career S. I mean, I see. Obviously there's going to be a career S, right? But it's they're doing it all different because they're actually launching with the hardtop, convertible, and Targa. So you could get a 992.2 Targa GTS right off the bat if you wanted to, which is pretty cool. I don't know. They're changing it up. I think they just did maybe the most development work. Like, I know Jorg didn't mention it when he was on our show, but Jorg Bergmeister was the development driver. They just did a lot of Nürburgring time with the GTS, and it's just probably more developed than the Carrera S. Probably, you know, they wrapped GTS and started on Carrera S or something like that. But, yeah, I mean, sounds pretty cool. I noticed the internet is, of course, worried about the wrong things, which I love.
One of the things that I heard about was a push button start as opposed to the weird half thumb that's stuck so, into the, you know, which I, mean? I like, look, I just hopped into the GT3 RS. All right. I've done one drive home, but then I remembered, oh, it's got that weird thumb that I got to turn. I don't like that.
That's my,
I'm holding a key and I got a thumb to turn. What is that?
That's my exact. I want my 19 cent piece of Happy Meal plastic. God damn it. Like, it's well, not a either, Porsche anymore.
Yeah. Let me put the key in or give me a button. So I'm going to be very happy about the button.
I just, again, like I said, the internet, they just,
what
the
else are they mad thing. About?
The physical tachometer went away in place of a fully digital screen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which, I understand that. I'm down with. Okay.
Yeah, I get that.
I can be annoyed about that.
If they create a nice, and they have before had a nice tach that has a nice clicky move up and down, and, you know, we've seen all versions of it.
Yeah. I think that, you know, on higher end cars, you'll see analog tachs come back as like, you know, the Thorsten Veblen's theory of the leisure class. Like, you know, if every car has a digital screen, then the expensive ones will get the analog back.
I wonder if like Vegas slot machine players felt this things changed and turned into video. They went, I missed the spinning of the wheel and the sound. All of the,
you know what they felt.
They know feel exactly nothing.
How they felt. Yeah.
They feel zero. Well, let's talk about the 992 GTS, which is pretty exciting. I mean, the stats were pretty great. Mm-hmm. Sub zero to 60 times. Disappointingly, no manual gearbox. But okay, if it's going to be that technologically advanced, I don't want it. They call it a T hybrid instead of an E hybrid because I guess you can't plug it in.
Yeah, it's a turbo hybrid also.
Right, but a single turbo now.
As opposed
to two turbos.
And a bigger engine.
Because one of the e-motors is on that turbo. And I guess they now claim turbo lag is gone forever. Haven't they made this claim before?
Well, I remember years ago, I was at the Leipzig factory, and they were showing us, like, if they deem it to be flawed once it's manufactured, but before it gets shipped, mm-hmm. they have a special room where they bring it in, and they have an iPad, which you scan it, and it'll show you, you know, the millimeters are off. And so the guy's like, so we will fix the flaw and we will make it perfect. And I go, what do you mean by perfect? He goes, plus or minus 0.5 millimeters. That's perfect. I go, right. Oh, that's perfect. Okay. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
So yes, it was gone, but now it's even more gone.
What else? Active aero in the bumper, mm-hmm. which looked pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. People were split on that on the internet. Some people thought it looked kind of toothy. Some people thought it looked kind of cool. I think it looks kind of cool.
You know, with all of these, all of these decades of cars that I've driven, right? If I'm like 70 to 75% liking a thing, if it drives great when I get it, I end up liking all of the other little style aesthetics.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So if you're first kind of going, huh, that's kind of weird. Like, remember the 992 when it first came out? Oh, look at the back.
Yep.
Right? Oh, now oh. I love it. I mean, love it.
I was telling the story. I think it was the 1963 Geneva show. Could have been the Munich show. I can't remember. But where they first showed it was the 901 at the time when they first showed it. The press reaction to it was, well, that's it for Porsche.
Yeah.
Look how big and fat this back seat. What is this? A Buick? Why does it have a back seat? You know? So ever since before the 911 was even the 911, every innovation, like, right? Remember air cooling. Remember when the 997 went from NA to mm-hmm. turbo and mm-hmm. that was the end?
Yep. It's over.
And now everyone says the 997.2 GTS is the last real Porsche. You know what I mean? So it's just one of those things. I'm excited to drive it. I want to reserve like full judgment until, you know, I drive the thing, but you know, you saw York's smile when we interviewed him about it. Like, it's
going to be great. As long as things go fast, people will be happy.
Yeah.
Now the 911 is standard as a two-seater as well. That was another revelatory statement. If you want to put the back seats in there for your kids or your amputee friends, as we like to joke, it's an option and it's free. But if you don't say anything, you're just going to get a two-seater.
What do you think of that? It's
totally fine. You have the it sounds like you just have the option to do whatever you like. But you know, for me, a standard 911 has always meant a backseat. I've always wanted a backseat in my standard cars, and in my GT cars, I don't.
That's the magic of a 911, right? Is that in a pinch, suddenly it's a really practical car,
and it's a fun time.
When you get
four people in a 911, it's really fun.
It's a good time, right?
Yeah. It's usually a short drive. There's usually champagne involved.
Right, movie and dinner. Done.
Yeah,
yeah. So I'm excited. I think it'll be good. I have a feeling.
There's also new paint to sample colors. 11 new colors added to the palette.
Like Shawnee Peach or something?
Trying to keep up with McLaren. You ever go to build a car on McLaren? You've got that 750S.
Yeah, yeah.
There's ridiculous. Tons of colors.
MSO, baby.
They have, let's see.
The first two are some dude.
El Burl Green.
Which is killer.
Vers Dejmeg Metallic. Is a Ferrari source color making debut. Classic color Frozen Berry Metallic for Matt Farah.
Finally shows up on 911.
Let's see. Sean Peach.
Sean Peach, yeah. There's some guy, Sean, and then the next one is his last name.
Nashy Blue.
Yeah, it's Sean Nash, I think, is the guy.
That's a guy? What do you mean? He named a color after a guy?
Two. There's Sean Nash is one guy, and there's Peach.
Who is Sean Nash?
I saw the post. Let me see if I can find it. I'll dig it out.
Shouldn't they be naming colors after all of us? I mean, shouldn't they have said Matt?
Zuckerman Black.
Matt Farah Pink. Who is this guy?
Zuckerman Sean Nash. Swine.
They had Eberl Green, Vers Delt Wim Metallic, which is kind of a rich green metallic, very greeny green. GTS Red, nice. Frozen Berry Metallic. Dolomite Silver Metallic. These were offered, I thought, a couple years ago in Guards Red, a new Guards Red. So there you go.
Okay, I got it. Ready?
Yeah.
Sean Peach, named after Sean Wotherspoon. The solid peach color originates from the sneaker designer's collaboration with Porsche on their Taycan Cross Turismo art car.
Oh.
Nashy Blue, the solid medium blue, is another one of the four colors from Sean Wotherspoon's Taycan art car, named after Sean's son, Nash.
I don't. What are they doing?
We got to collaborate.
I'm disappointed in what you just read.
We got to collaborate. The Spike Car Radio.
How about sock manufacturer Yellow? Dizzy Montgomery, who designed one of the socks for. So we're going to name that.
Oh boy!
Sock manufacturer Green, Yellow.
How about your? How about Pat Long? How about someone? Come on. Dempsey, let's come up with, you know what I'm saying?
The designers. What we've done
instead is there was a fella who designed a scarf that at one of the cars of coffee his wife was wearing, and it was this is what we call it. So we call it scarf
See,
blue.
This is it. Designers pick the colors, not the GT teams, not the engineers.
Sneaker guys.
You know, Sean, we're going to meet Sean. He's going to be the coolest guy in the world.
I'm sure he's great. But he gets two colors. His son. Well,
Nash.
Yeah, hey, you know what? We'll just name it after my son. Who's he? Who are you? Who are you?
Well, I designed Sean.
Okay, anyway. Race Deck. Over two decades ago, Race Deck was invented the cost-effective, durable, and truly do-it-yourself modular floor system engineered for the garage. Race Deck's multi-patented design allows for easy installation without all the hassles and mess of toxic epoxy coatings, transforming your garage in just hours, not days. I love my hangar floor so much. Race Deck, it was such a big change, and I went down there, and I was like, huh? And now I am down there. Looking at my floor, not my cars. It's the weirdest thing that's ever happened.
I got to get a hanger.
It's the weirdest thing that's ever happened because he solved, Jorgen Mahler, who founded this company, solved so many problems for me. I've been down there for 20 years, and they're fixed with Race Deck. Trust me, if you're putting some flooring down for your hanger, if you're putting some flooring down anywhere, these are the tiles you want to buy. They can handle rolling loads in excess of 80,000 pounds. They don't chip, peel, or stain. Over 33 patents, product line, 20 styles, countless even more color options. How about a race deck paint a sample color? These guys have contributed more to the automotive world than Sneaker Guy.
How about we name one after my dog?
Okay. Oh, okay.
Whatever you say, Sean.
Lucky Purple.
Oh, okay. Do you have any more things or family members we could name paint to sample colors after?
I have an aunt that I really like.
We're really nerding out here. We're getting angry about paint to sample inspiration.
My Aunt Susan is really a nice lady.
I'm sure.
She has a rosacea spot that is...
Susan Rosacea Red. Named after Jonny Lieber.
I'm sure Sean is a swell guy. And if he wants to send us a bunch of sneakers, he can change our mind. We're going to stop making fun of him.
As long as they're not in Shawnee Peach. I want the other color.
Shawnee Peach. Just call it Shawnee Peach. Let's go home. It's 4:30. We must go home. Shawnee Peach, good enough. Does he have a kid? Yes. That kid's name is Green. Let's go home. Anyway, shop at racetech.com and use code SPIKE911 for 15% off and free shipping. Racetech.com, use code SPIKE911 for exclusive 15% off and free shipping. Thank you, Racetech. We love Racetech. We love you. All right, there's so much to talk about here. As I said, we're going to call Zuckerman in a minute, but you were just at Villa d'Este, Dave.
Oh,
right?
Man. I at Villa
d'Este? Yeah. And I went there 1 year with my wife and Alange and Sonia. Ben Clymer set me up with that, and it was the greatest, I have to say, the greatest trip of my life.
Can I ask you one question?
Yes.
Did you stay at the hotel at Villa d'Este?
No, we stayed at the Hotel Tremezzo, which was with the most beautiful tennis court out behind it. And oh my God, every minute of that vacation.
Yeah.
What was it like for you?
It was
any beauty, every
fantastic
angle, right?
It's a ridiculous setting. And, you know, as you know, if you're part of the press, in quotes, you get to go in early before the very, very limited exclusive crowd show up. So, right. That was, those cars, it was kind of like little light drizzle on these beautiful cars. And for me, I walk in, there's a Porsche 959 in, a really cool dark blue. Right behind it, roof yellow bird prototype. And, in my formative years, I was 12 when that car came out.
Wow.
And, that was all I dreamed about. It was the fastest car in the world.
Was our buddy Roof there?
Oh, yeah. He was there. Not only was he there, I happened to be standing there when he got judged. And Aloisa was making, that's his daughter, was making the point that the founder of a first-time entrant being present hasn't happened in over 90 years. So, when Villa d'Este had a Bugatti, they brought Ettore Bugatti along. That's how historic this was. It was fantastic. I was bursting with pride. Aloisa and Estonia Roof were beside themselves. And it was the coolest thing. It was the coolest thing.
I don't know. I can't say enough great things. I mean, from the moment you get there, everywhere you look is beauty. The beauty of the lake, the beauty of the hotels, the foods, the coffees, the drives, the little roads. I remember when I was there, they said, would you like to drive a 1952 Ferrari up and down? I said, what? You know, every moment of it was like, am I dreaming? Am I absolutely dreaming? And then we show up to the show and they lay the cars out. I mean, you compliment Lufgekult, not you, but people do with how they lay the cars out. They got nothing on this show. Zero. Look at the cars in the background here and you just lose your mind.
That was because we got there the first night we were there. They revealed the art car. That's the new, it's the MV8 hybrid Le Mans car. Mm-hmm. Julie Marutu, who I got to spend some time with, super cool lady, but it was her art car. But the spot where they reveal it, if you were going to make Tale of the Dragon, what's the show? The House of the Dragon. Mm-hmm. It looks like that. It's ridiculous, old medieval beauty and just flowers and the lake and the this. And yeah, it's
incredible. We need one more color. Yeah, what about Marutu Melon? Let's go. Let's go eat sausage. It's getting late. It's 3:30. Marutu Melon. That's it.
And that was, I was actually, that art car is super cool. It's like that, that was really neat. So at
Villa, do you have a shot of it?
Yeah, I have several shots of it. All right, at Villa Urba, where you take a little water taxi.
Sounds
over.
Like a weed store.
It could be Urbe. But anyways, you take a water taxi over, and they had the Calder art car, the Roy Lichtenstein art car, Warhol, Jeff Koons, wow, and then hers was in the middle. And yeah, like, it's rad. They're rad. And this one, hers, I think, is kind of might go down in history as like the best
Did
one.
You go to the black tie event at the end of
no,
it?
No, we weren't invited. No journalist scumbags.
Well, we no, I got invited to
that. I know you were with Ayn Longa. By the way, do you know the
and
winner?
I'm not a journalist. Do you know but, the you know, I did hang out with the journalists at all the events because they were always out back smoking.
Yeah.
The cigarettes, and I had cigars, and I was just in heaven.
Yeah.
Just talking about cars, smoking cigars with really fun, educated car guys.
Do you know the winner of the concorso gets a Longasano?
Really?
You win. And I saw it. It's killer. It was like a salmon dialed, wow, rose gold, double split, whatever.
Just, I didn't know how much I loved those watches until I wore those watches in that setting. Like, we showed up to the hotel. They just open a briefcase. They go, pick a watch for
have
yourself.
A watch.
And you're just like, what? You will give it back.
But pick what else?
My wife was like, what is this? Dude, what? I go, This is a weird world I'm a part of.
Honey, you know your car? This watch costs four times as much.
Just take that watch. Just quickly take that watch and swap it out with the fake one I brought.
Yeah. It was super fun.
And we took those.
It was BMW took me. They were awesome. And super, super fun time.
Vertistein Tires is back. They are the official tire partner of Spike's Car Radio. That's a big statement. I'll say it again. The official tire partner. They get our full endorsement. They have been providing tires for us for the last year. Erica has the Quad Track Pros on her Tesla Model Y. Going to get them on the new Model Y now. We got two already. Going to quiet that ride down. Jerry has them on his Volkswagens. He's got the Sprint Classic. Jonny, you have them on the Rivian.
And the Alpha, which is going back tomorrow. But yes, they're there.
And most of all, I get most excited. I have them on my Land Rover Series 2A from 1971. With grip classics that completely, quieted down that ride by about, I would say, 15-20%. Really made that truck lovely, easier to turn. Can't say enough good things about Vredestein. They've had a long relationship with Giorgetto Giugiaro, who is a legendary automotive designer, and I say it every week, but I'm going to tell you again, he's designed a lot of great designs. The BMW M1, the DeLorean, the Lotus Esprit, the Maserati Giblet. The Alfa Romeo Alfetta GT, and also Seiko Speedmaster Ripley watches.
And the Bishop.
The Seiko Master LCD driving watch worn by Anton Senna. And what?
I think he did the Bishop watch.
The Astron Solar GPS.
Oh, that might be the one.
And he did the sidewall. So on those Tesla tires, though, he did looked at them. Yeah, these look kind of cool. Why do they look cool?
No, I know.
It's pretty cool stuff. If you're looking for tires, you need new tires on cars, new and old. Vredestein, VREDESTEIN.com. Go to Vredestein.com to find your local Vred dealer. They are everywhere here in the U.S. and around the world. Easy to find.
Get your Vreds.
Get your Vreds.
Get your Vreds.
They should change the name to Vreds.
I mean,
the VR, the Vreds, the Vredestein. People get a little confused about it, but they're one of the oldest tire manufacturers in the world. They're really great.
Since like 1915 or something?
They're the Dutch. They're this close to being, you know, who?
Who? Belgian. Luxembourgian.
We're going to call Zuckerman.
Uh-oh.
So as I said before, he's got a story for you. He's not just going to be reporting for the nursing home. Because, like, why would we do that?
But could he be just reporting from the nursing home?
No, he forgot to tell a story last week about Porsches and something that went wrong with his Porsche.
Oh.
Here, I wrote a little song for this.
Oh, good, 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 good.
See?
Zuckerman is visiting his mom in the nursing home, knowing that real soon he'll live there too. Zuckerman will be king of the nursing home.
You like this?
I love it. I smell a hit.
Splitting the wigs of the elderly residents.
like Tony Soprano in a wheelchair.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
And then it just ends.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, it's great. It's I can't wait. He will be running the nursing home.
He will.
Hey, Spike.
I do love this app. I mean,
hey, Spike, I got a cute nurse. She's got more daddy issues than Parenting Magazine.
I was going to play this song last week, but I thought it was too mean to you, Jonny.
To me?
But I'll play it to you right now.
Yeah, thanks.
What's better? I'll ask you then. A show without Jonny Lieberman.
It's too mean.
No, it's great. It's great.
But I like the
two. Is there anything better than not being interrupted? Where the story that doesn't make sense.
I just thought.
Oh, it's great.
Forget about the words. It's a good song.
No. It's great. I don't mind.
Listen to this one. All right, I know. Now I'm just playing songs.
I was talking about this with Farrah. I said, if people would ever actually learn what upsets me, I'd be an easy target.
No, you're like a comedy writer. Say whatever you want to, and you don't get upset.
It doesn't bother
that's
me.
That's good.
Yeah, no, there are things that really bother me, but no one's figured them out yet.
We're joking around here, yeah, folks. Yeah. Boy, they wouldn't survive in a writer's room because that's just all hour, every hour you're ripping on each other. This was, I think, a song I wrote for the Scene Through Glass guys. Who were coming out to Baldwin Hills, but then Sam didn't bring Tony. But listen to how good this is.
What's better?
That's another song about you. So here, this one right here. Listen to this.
Today on Spike's Car Radio, Sam and Tony from our sister show across the pond, seen through glass. We're here in Baldwin Hills, smoking cigars and Rufus. The dog is licking his. We're here in Baldwin Hills, smoking cigars and Rufus.
I think Rufus is a girl.
The dog is licking his own ass.
I mean, that's pretty good.
That's the same voice as the original Where's Zuckerman. I recognize that fake singer.
You recognize it?
I recognize him.
All right. Yeah, anyway, let's get Zuckerman on the phone.
Oh, boy.
We're so far away. So apparently he's in the nursing home. There's our first ring. The first ring, ladies and gentlemen.
Hello.
Hello. Is this Paul Zuckerman? Can we use your voice on the air?
I'm very frightened. Thank God you called.
Where are you? Are you in the nursing home that you're going to be living in?
Well, I'm here, and I'm hoping they don't get to me. Actually, I don't even know why I'm whispering. They can't hear a thing. None of these people can.
So when this visit takes place with your mom, do you stay there the whole day? Or is it, it's not just 1 hour and then go to get something to eat?
Okay, we bring the food in, then we have something to eat, then she probably has to take a little rest, and then we come back and eat some more. Basically, we just shovel the food in.
Fantastic. You're a good son, yeah, Zuckerman.
There's not much left to do when you get to a certain age.
What do you talk about?
We were talking about you. We were talking about Lieberman. And it doesn't make a lot of sense, but, you know, it keeps the conversation going.
Yeah.
We talk about things she, you know, we talk about the kids. We talk about the weather. We talk a little bit about politics, some of the historic things that are happening. Sometimes she asks for people that are no longer here on the planet, but then she reorients quickly.
All right.
Yeah.
How are the memory people?
This place is full of them. And I could honestly, you know, I can evade them, but they're persistent. They just keep coming in one direction.
Are they targeting you specifically, or it's just coincidence? Hello.
Oh, we lost him. The memory people got him.
Oh, the memory people ate Zuckerman.
I think they got him.
No,
it says he's still connected.
Interesting.
Wow, that was spooky. He said he was calling from inside the house, and suddenly,
yep,
he's done. Here, let me try.
All right, well,
back.
R.I.P. Paul Zuckerman, our new co-host is Zuckerman's detailer.
No, he's got a good Porsche story that he wants to share, but let's see. His phone probably just went dead.
He didn't charge it.
Yeah.
What happened?
I think one of them tried to get me.
All right, well, quick, let's hear your Porsche story, because I thought it would be beneficial for our audience to hear.
Everybody needs to hear this. This is remarkable, and it goes to the entire VW Automotive Group. But not long ago, Andrea's 911, her 992 Cabriolet.
Andrea, your wife.
Would not start. There was something going on electrically, and they came from Galpin. They picked it up. They took it to the shop there, and she every couple of days got a text message from the service advisor that it was, you know, they got the part, it should be ready, and then no, that didn't work, and then they got another part and it should be ready, and no, that didn't work. Then I got a call from Dean, our friend Dean, and I said, I was wondering why he was calling, and he said that he needed to talk to me, that it was a much bigger job, that the wiring harness needed to be replaced because rats and mice had eaten it. So what the fuck are you talking about? What are you fucking talking about? And he said, yeah, it's we can do it. We can do this kind of half-assed way that costs $9,000, and the whole wiring harness is $13,000. And I said, well, is that not warranty? And he said, no, there's an exclusion for things like, you know, wildlife. And I said, this isn't vandalism of some sort. This isn't. And he said, well, you could try putting it through your homeowners. And I said, look, the homeowners, we could barely get homeowners after the fire.
Right,
I'm not putting rat problems through. And I said, but I don't understand.
Zuckerman has rats.
Yeah, they have rats. The rat has rats. Yeah, birds of a feather
King
flock rat. Together. So,
King of the rats.
And then, and so I say to him, I don't understand, why would they do this? And he goes, you know, this is not uncommon. I said, what are you talking about, Dean? This is not uncommon. I've never heard of this. He goes, oh yeah, this happens all the time. I said, Porsche's making their cars out of rat food? And what are you talking about? And he says, well, actually, it's not just Porsche, it's the entire VW Automotive Group. And I said, what are you talking about? He says, the coating for the wiring harness is made out of some soy-based product that's irresistible to rats. They love this shit. And he goes, and then, you know, he whispers, he goes, Paulie, I need to tell you, we got four or five cars in here like this right now.
Wow.
So then I call up our old service advisor at Beverly Hills Porsche. I'll leave his name out of it. And I said, Eric, whoops. I said, Eric, do you have this?
Dean. Yeah. You might as well say Eric. They're good.
Say Eric. I said, Eric, yeah. And I said, Eric, I said, you ever hear of this rat business? And he goes, oh, yeah, I got two here right now. We usually get four or five a month.
Wow.
I said, well, at this point, if this is this prevalent, they need to warn people. They need to warn people. They, you know,
this is if you leave your car outside, rats are going to, it's like leaving a bowl of food out for the coyotes.
Exactly. It's exactly. This is like rat bait. This is rat bait without the snapper.
Is it specific to Porsche and the Volkswagen Group, or is it just all, you know, everybody using wires? Like, how do we know? It doesn't extend beyond, you know, Volkswagen Group.
Okay, so here's the deal. Well, one of them, apparently, universally, rats and mice like to nest where it's warm. In the old days, you find your cat on the hood of the car after you park it.
Yep.
Well, they want to go where it's warm. But once they go where it's warm, they find something to eat. So they're finding food and shelter in your 911. And I know that we park a Ford truck outside all the time. It's not of any interest to the rats. Ah.
So, Zuckerman, I'm waiting to hear the phrase class action.
Well, that's exactly where my mind is at.
Yes.
That's exactly where my mind is at. Because I'm going to pay $13,000 motherfucking dollars. and I'm just going to have new rat food installed.
But not.
And then I'm like filling the feeder. It's like filling a bird feeder, a very expensive bird feeder.
But that's the beauty of the tort system, right? Not just you. Everybody's paying $13,000 for new rat food.
Well, then I want the listeners to tell me if they have any rat stories too. Right. Because
well, everybody
I do
does.
Want
I mean, we've been hearing rat stories in cars.
Crowdsourcing rat stories.
Yeah, for decades. And not just outside, inside. We've had that issue down at Santa Monica Airport. You know, thankfully not any of my cars, but it's happened to some people I know. It's
But you know, I've had it where you hear about there's a nest in there and there's little rat babies in there. I've never heard about this wiring harness stuff. I think it did happen to our friend Jeff Greenberg years ago.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
And I think he said, leave it to me to buy a car that rats like to eat. Just my luck. Yeah,
there's
the whole
nothing special
you,
about
Jeff.
You, Jeff.
I would guess there's a lot of folks who listen to a story like that and go, oh, the rich guy's Porsche is getting eaten by rats. How poetic.
Yeah. I'm one of them.
And you know what? And they're right to think that. They're right to think that. Absolutely. Yes. It is. There is some justice in the
there
world.
Is some
there
justice
is
in the world.
But
there is
if you're,
karma.
If you're buying a Volkswagen ID4 and the rats are eating your wires, that also sucks.
But I think, wouldn't it be nice?
You know, ID4s don't get hot, do they?
I think the warranty should cover that. The Porsche warranty should cover that.
Well, they're going to say no, but I'm going to throw a fit. I'm going to throw an absolute fit, and I know a few lawyers that I'm going to call. It might even be just myself. I'm going to raise hell because
that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. Just for parking your car in the driveway.
Hey, what do you want? I'm busy. I need to talk to you.
Oh, I can't. Hey, Herr Porsche, let's talk about something.
We're going to sue Porsche. Why?
Finally.
Yeah, Professor Porsche, I want to talk to you about rats.
Oh, my God.
Zuckerman.
Put your swastika down. We need to talk
about rats.
All right. Well, that's a good story. That's a good story.
Yeah.
When do you come back now? Oh, you know, here's a better story, Zuckerman. And I hope you know this story. But the leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un, has been launching poop-filled balloons onto South Korea, over South Korea, because he's unhappy with them for some reason. He's been filling balloons full of poop, which then fall on South Korea and land with poop and feces in them.
Clearly, they have an office in the security department. It's probably called like Room 19, and there are three guys, the North Korean version of the three of us, sitting in there, coming up with ideas. How do we get back at those guys on the other side?
What's more terrifying, them with a nuclear weapon or that? Doesn't it undermine their whole nuclear arsenal?
Yeah, because with a nuclear weapon, it's over.
You're like, oh, man, I'm actually starting to fear them. Not so much anymore. They're filling balloons full of poop and flying them over. I mean, they've just undermined the entire nuclear program.
Well, did you hear about Did you hear about the sperm whale diarrhea defense?
What is that?
They caught a group of sperm whales attacked by a group of orcas, and their defense is they have massive diarrhea and then smash the diarrhea around with their tails, and that drives off the orcas because they start ingesting
the
diarrhea.
See, we thought you'd be feeling homesick, so we're sharing these stories with you.
Yes, so Lieberman, is that going to be your prison defense when you go to the big house and get you in the shower?
Hey, Paul, I'm the aggressor. Let's be honest.
A manly man. There you go.
A manly man.
The world needs them. Yes. And he's one of them.
All right.
Yes. Well, I'm going to go back in.
Thank you for checking in. Go back in.
Yeah.
You're a good son for doing what you do. You're an inspiration to millions, Zuckerman. Millions. Just know that.
Yes. And don't come by and see my mother at Lions Gate.
Don't sue Porsche until we get our ST. It won't be a Merry Christmas if we don't have that car. But you know what? I picked up the GT3 RS yesterday and just drove it back in traffic. But oh my God. I don't even want to talk about it yet because I haven't driven enough. But oh my God.
It's light years beyond anything we've had.
Oh, the lightness.
Yes.
I wasn't prepared for the light feeling, the lightness and the athleticism.
It's so good.
Oh my God.
It's shockingly good. It's so good. When you think they can't make a better product.
Dude, I have not even opened it up, but I was shocked at what I was feeling with my feet and with my hands, the steering and the, you know, everything was so nice. It actually, for the first time I went, there's a little bit of Ferrari in this thing. Just the sound and the way it shifts. There's such an exotic feel to it. It's what a car.
And then wait till you push it. It's insane.
I haven't had it over 2,000 RPMs. It's unbelievable. And it was such a memorable drive, which is always a good sign. The last one that felt like that was the GT2 RS, where I drove it from your joint in Beverly Hills. And I was like, Oh my God.
6 years.
Yeah.
And this is so, and I think the GT2 RS may remain faster, but this is so much more technical.
Right. Well, it's faster in a straight line, but curves? No way.
So around the ring, this new GT3 must be faster then.
Yeah.
No, because the ring's a big horsepower track. It's just, there's so many straights, but it's just the cornering that thing does, especially
the active aero.
Yeah, the downforce is nuts.
It's
unreal. It's the only car I've ever driven where it really does feel slower in a straight line than on a corner. It's a weird, weird car.
That, I agree 100%. That's a really good comment. That sums it up. That really does. Yeah,
it's wild. Well, it's so good.
Yeah. All right, man.
Okay, gentlemen.
Well, thanks for taking time, my friend.
If I perish, it's been nice. I'll be back tomorrow night if they don't get me.
All right.
Oh, they're going to get you.
We're gonna see to it. Okay. Goodbye.
Yes. Goodbye.
Well, look at that.
God, those photos he's been sending. It looks like if you did like a tour of this is where they shot The Sopranos in 1983.
What photo did he send of the
him eating the hot Italian dogs? Restaurants and like the
these hot dogs are good. That's what he said, something like that.
It was like that.
What was it that he was eating? I couldn't tell.
It was Italian food, but just like
I can't believe how good this is. Was he in Philadelphia?
He's like just outside. It's like, if you go just outside of like New York, suddenly you're back in 1983. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
If you go outside of like 100 miles outside of LA, it's like a different universe.
Yes.
New York's even like starker. And it's just like, yeah. So I think he's near Philly.
Food does feel better when you go back east. It does.
Some of it.
Zuckerman is visiting his mom in the nursing home.
Let's play him out.
Knowing that real soon he'll live there too.
I'm going to call myself
Zuckerman. Wow. Will be king.
Like Crosby, Stills, and Nash. I'm going to make this song go longer, I think. I'm going to write a new part.
Splitting the wigs of the elderly residents. Like Tony Soprano in a wheelchair.
All right, that's enough of that. AG1!
Oh!
AG1! The reason Zuckerman's not in the nursing home right now. 6 months he will be. Is because he drinks AG1 every day. No exceptions. Just one scoop mixed with water once a day, every day. And it makes us feel energized, focused, nourished, strong, ready to take on the day, ready to fight the memory people in the nursing home. That's because each serving of AG1 delivers the daily dose of vitamins, minerals, pre and probiotics, and more. It's a powerful, healthy habit that's also powerfully simple. And all of us drink AG1 here.
I had it this morning.
We really do. Bill Miller, Malibu Kitchen, big AG1. Erica First and Spike First. We're all doing it. We all are tired of pills. We just take our little packets. We travel with them. We mix them with water, and then we're off.
Remember 3 years ago when Zuckerman gave Bill 3 months to live?
Yeah.
AG1.
It's keeping him alive. If there's one product I had to recommend to elevate your health, it's AG1, and that's why I partnered with them for so long. God, they have been on the show for years now. So if you want to take ownership of your health, start with AG1, try an AG1. Try AG1 and get a free one-year supply of vitamin D3 and K2 and 5 free AG1 travel packs for your summer vacation with your first purchase exclusively at drinkag1.com/spike911. What's up?
I'll use the travel packs at Villa Desna.
They do help.
They were great. That's all coming back from all that champagne and the dessert buffet. Need the AG1.
The buffet.
The dessert buffet was just fucking royal. So
that's drinkag1.com/spike911. Check it out. All right.
Oh.
Our guest today, Ryan Condal, Here's what was cool about this. I watched the season. I was a big Game of Thrones.
Huge.
I am. Yeah. I loved it.
Great.
Erica was really, you know, she's not, she loved it.
Yeah.
I'm like, I keep telling her, you're a sci-fi nerd. She goes, no, I'm not. I go, listen to the shows you love. You love these fantasy shows. You love these sci-fi shows.
My wife was, she read
really
all the books.
It's interesting, right?
And yeah, my wife read all the books and she's like, you got to watch this show. And I'm like, I don't, it's Dungeons and Dragons. I don't care.
I can't keep track of any of the names or the, I know Westeros or the worlds, but I love the power struggles and I love the violence.
It's so good. She made me watch that first episode. I was totally against it. The second, like the brothers humping the sister and they throw the kid out the window, I'm like, this is the greatest show of all time.
It's the greatest show ever.
This is it. And I read all the books.
That's what I always say. If you haven't seen it yet, you got to put it in your thing.
It actually is so good.
Yeah. It is good. So when they announced that they were going to do a prequel, I was on board. I needed more Game of Thrones. It was over. They have this prequel, House of the Dragon. They've had their first season. It was a huge season for them. Lots of awards, blah, blah, blah. The series launched on Max. I remember watching it going and thinking in my head going, God, you know, I love talking to car folks, but I'd really love to talk to the people who make this show.
The dragon people.
But I don't have a regular talk show anymore. Well, then I get this call, this email from a publicist in London who goes, hey, you know, how would you like the showrunner, Ryan Condal, on the show?
Wow.
House of the Dragon. He's a Porsche guy. and we have a new season coming up next week, June 16th, 2024. I said, are you kidding me? Absolutely. I have a ton of questions for him about the show. He's got a ton of questions for me about Porsche, especially because he lives in London. And he's trying to figure out, do I get a car there and drive on the wrong side of the road? But I pointed him in the right direction of our British friends over there. And
he's an American guy.
He's an American guy.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, should I wait? And I'm like, dude, they're going to have you be, you know. Well, you're going to hear the interview right now.
Yeah,
you're going to be making 20 seasons of this thing. So get something now. Have some fun. Here's my interview with Ryan Condal, the showrunner of House of the Dragon.
Spikes Car Radio.
Yeah, cool.
I'm really excited you're on the show, by the way. I'm a huge fan of your work.
Oh, thanks.
I remember when I was watching season one of House of the Dragon, I was like, I said to my wife, like, I really would love to talk to somebody from this show. I mean, it's one of the Game of Thrones franchise was an amazing thing. And your series has followed it up wonderfully.
Oh, thanks.
It's a good place to start. I mean, were you nervous? You know, there was a lot at stake here, right? Game of Thrones was a phenomenon for HBO. They make a pilot that not a lot of folks know about, I think, with Naomi Watts, right? For about, I think, $30 million that doesn't go well.
Yeah.
And then they call you up and say, would you like to try? Do I have that right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's sort of how it went. This process started sort of about 6 or 7 years ago, where they knew that the original show was ending and they started looking for the successor. They were trying to figure out what was going to follow it up because it was an unprecedented success by many metrics, the most successful drama television series of all time. And they tried a bunch of pilots. So they put a bunch of things into development, and this was the one that George cared the most about and wanted to tell. And they had actually taken another development attempt at this previously, and it just didn't work out for whatever reason. And George knew me from kind of fan stalking him when I was a younger writer. And I made a pilot about 12 years ago in Santa Fe, which is where George lived. And I was a huge fan of his books and everything going back, you know, now 20, 25 years. I discovered them when I got out of college and just kind of took to them. I was a big Tolkien fan. I mean, as you can tell, looking around me, I'm a giant nerd. I'm a gainfully employed nerd. So I ended up by a sort of random happenstance, the whole like we're living in a simulation thing, shooting a pilot in Santa Fe, which is not a place where a lot of people go to shoot pilots. And I knew that he lived there. And I just said to my agents, we shared an agency. We were both at WME. And I just said, hey, I'm going to be there for like 2 months. Can I buy him dinner? and he took to it, and we hit it off. And he thought it was cool that I brought a pilot into his backyard. So he came to set. People are like, do you know George R. R. Martin? And I was like, I guess I do. And it kicked off a friend.
I can't believe this guy would just show up to dinner.
It was amazing. It was amazing.
It's unbelievable. Were you freaking out that there he is now? Were you panicked at all? What are we going to talk about here? Or
completely. It's like now I have him. What you have to ask him something, and you can't just ask nerdy questions about the book.
So what did you say? I mean, did you expect him to say yes to that? I have to be honest with you. I would say no right away to a dinner with someone I didn't know.
Who is this lunatic?
Yeah, and he sits down. Where did you guys eat? The Olive Garden?
We ate at Maria's, which is this really cool, like Santa Fe cuisine, you know, the whole green chili, red chili.
Love it.
It was awesome. And
did you weren't at all nervous about that?
I guess I was nervous, but it was not a job interview. It was just sort of a fan meeting. And, you know, they warn you, it's probably happened to you in your career. You know, you have to be careful about meeting idols of yours because you.
Correct.
You don't know how it's going to go. And I've had good experiences and bad experiences with that. But it went well. And I knew he had worked in television because he sort of started as a novelist. And then he worked for about 10 years in the 80s and in development and you know, staff television. He worked on Beauty and the Beast and the Twilight Zone redo. So I just asked him about his TV career. And I thought that was a kind of an equal plane that we could meet on. We hit it off. It was just a light friendship. And then he would come to LA and check in on me and say, like, let's have a beer. He would come to LA to win Emmys basically. And, and he just realized over time that I knew his world very well. And I had that pilot busted, but, my next pilot got picked up at, NBC Universal, on the cable side. And, I was, you know, running the show and he liked it. And, so anyway, all kind of things came together and he just called me out to coffee one day and said, do you want a job?
Amazing. Unbelievable story.
That was
just
6 years ago.
From being a fan and just calling this guy up and taking that risk. And then you get to steer this ship. But back to my original question, though, did you, you know, you don't seem like a guy. You seem like, you know, you've got a perfect showrunner brain on you. But were you feeling the pressure? I mean, I, as a fan of Game of Thrones, was feeling the pressure for you in that first episode, season one, season one, like, oh, please, this better be great. And it was, a great season. But how Thanks. Was it for you? I want to know how it was for you. And then I've got a follow-up question I've been dying to ask.
Okay, very good. Yeah, I wouldn't say there was pressure. There were nerves. I think the pressure, as you know, the pressure isn't actually making the show and getting the scripts ready on time and getting it under budget and finishing your days and then cutting the thing. So by the time it came out, I knew that we had made something pretty good. My only question was, are the fans going to show up and are they going to receive it? So there are nerves around that, but I think the pressure was the 3 years that led into that. And we did this through COVID. We developed it through COVID. We were scouting Spain in March of 2020. Wow. And suddenly it was like, hey, you guys shouldn't go to the airport. And it's like, what do you mean don't go to the airport?
Was there, you know, apprehension? Is it HBO that's producing it?
Yeah.
Was there, you know, so they have a $30 million busted pilot. Did they want to see a pilot shot or did they pick up the season and just say, we like these scripts, we're shooting it?
They went right to series with us. And it was a function of, I think, having had that experience with the previous one where these shows are so huge and so expensive that in a way, if you find the right thing, it's almost better to gamble on a thing that you can air versus a thing that if it doesn't work or doesn't quite come together, because you can always go and reshoot parts of the pilot and pick it up. We did not. I mean, we had a really great, you know, great first episode. And we have, you know, Miguel Sapochnik worked on the first season, who was one of their top directors from the original series. So we had a lot of elements kind of going in our way, but they picked us up right to series. So I went from kind of thinking one day that I think they're going to pick us up to pilot. And then the whole network called me. And as you know, like, they don't all call you to like crush your dreams. That's the agents call you for that. So I thought we were getting good news, but I thought they were picking up our pilot. And then it was like, hey, you guys are going to series and you're moving to England.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's so great. That's so good. That's so funny. People, I know that, but the listeners have no idea what we're talking about. But that is a very funny observation. The bad news comes through the agent. The good news comes from a small group of people who all want to attach themselves to your success.
Yes, and give you the good news and smile.
And give you the good news for once.
Bask in your joy, the brief joy that we get as writers.
Let me nerd out for a little while. All right.
Yes.
So I'm watching the first few episodes of the season, and I am blown away by your actress, Millie. Is it Millie Alcock? Is that
her name? Yeah.
Blown away by this. I have no idea who this is. She hits the screen. My wife and I are like, my God, this girl is a star. Is a star, right? And now, three episodes in, that character, we do a time cut. We jump ahead, and the actress is gone. And I totally understand why you had to do it for story. But was there a moment where you guys were watching these first couple episodes air where you went, maybe we should do the whole season with Millie, because this girl is red hot as far as star power?
Yeah. I mean, we knew kind of that was really going back. That was the craziest gamble of season one, was doing the recasting midstream. The Crown had done it successfully.
Yep.
With Matt Smith, one of our stars, but they did it between seasons. And it was this balance of, we need to age the characters up. I don't think we can tell an entire story about Rhaenyra's childhood, because it's all about marriages and, people dying, falling off horses and things like that. There wasn't enough kind of action and incident in it. You have to get later in their lives when they have kids, because that's where all the drama really builds up. So that was our boldest move. So we cast the older actors first. So Emma Darcy and Olivia Cooke were cast first, and they're fantastic. Both of them are fantastic.
Unbelievable. Fantastic.
So it was really hitting the lottery in the reverse, where it's like, we knew we had great, actors to carry us through the series. And then we got Millie and Emily Carey, who played the young Allison, and it was an embarrassment of riches.
It really was. I was just like, God, I would like to now divide the first season up into two separate seasons. So for prequels and sequels, let's take season one and do more episodes for Millie, and let's do a prequel to the second half. But it's none of my business anymore. I don't even know why I'm bringing this up.
They're going to be looking to spin this one off too, Spike. So
what's that?
They're going to be looking to spin this one off eventually too. So come out and do it.
So here's my next question. You got, so this book is based, the series is based on Fire and Blood, the book by
George? Yes, correct.
Okay. How, now you're tight with George, you're working with a guy you've always admired, and he's written this book a certain way. How much artistic license do you have as a writer to change it the way you see it?
I mean, it's always tricky. And Fire and Blood, and I forgive you and anyone else who hasn't read it. It's a great book, but it's a book for the fans versus a book for the masses. Mm-hmm. It's written like a medieval history. So George is a huge fan of medieval histories, and he wrote what he calls a fake history within his own world. So it's actually historical accounts of the events of this period, written by three competing viewpoints who all have a different take on the history. So it's this Rashomon story written and then this happened on this day, and this happened on this day, and these two got married, and we don't know why this happened, but this guy says that he thinks this thing happened. So it's not a traditional narrative, and you don't have scenes, and you have snippets of dialogue sometimes from court accounts and things like that, but you don't have scenes of dialogue, and you don't have the character's internal thoughts, which you do in the original series. So there is less material to work with, which is an adapter's dream, because it gives you tons of latitude, but you're also living in fear every day of working with this revered text and this revered universe with fans who have very strong opinions, and it can keep you up at night. So I always kind of trusted when I set out to make the show, I just kept telling myself, I want to make the show that I want to see as a fan. And I think as long as I kept that as my true north compass heading, I felt like I could see my way through it. And that, I think, it's led us to where we are. I'm very proud of season two, which is about to come out. And I think that I've stayed true to myself, and that I think that's the thing that I can walk away with and keep my chin up about.
And what is the writer's room look like for you? Are you one of these guys who writes all the episodes himself, or do you like to bring in a group of people and break story? How do you work the whole situation?
No, ran a very traditional writer's room. I have a fantastic team around me. This is not a job anybody can kind of do alone. It's just not that show. We run two first units every day, shooting at the same time. So there's a fire unit and a blood unit shooting different scenes from different episodes with different directors, different pieces of the cast, because it's the only way you can make the show within the 7 month period that we shoot it. Otherwise it would take you, you know, we do 230 to 250 shoot days sometimes, depending on the season. But that's happening, you know, two at a time essentially. And that's how
so are you in post right now and working on a new season right now?
Yeah, so we're doing both right now. So we're in post, final touches. We have three episodes left to deliver. Three and a half episodes left to deliver. We're doing the final stages of episode five, and we're deep into writing season three. So because these things fold over, I need to have a traditional writer's room, and I have this wonderful writing partner named Sarah Hess, who wrote all of season one with me and is excellent. And her first job was Deadwood, and then worked on House for a million years, and then did Orange is the New Black. She's been at the Emmys so many times. Like they have a seat for her. She's fantastic. So she kind of runs the room day to day. And I check in and then write scripts, and we whack everything up. And then I'm running back and forth between a writer's office and post here in London.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Are you married? Do you have a family? Is everybody living
there? Yep. I am married to two little girls. They are in school here. And like we moved out, they were 4 and 2 when we moved. So, you know, now they're 8 and 6. And
this is their British accents yet.
The little one a bit, but they go to an international school. So it's like the bar from Star Wars. There's just lots of, they don't have an accent, but the little one can actually do this incredible, sort of stagey British accent that actually is pretty authentic. So I'm very proud of it.
Amazing. There you go. Yeah. Do you get cut in on any of the travel that results of House of the Dragon, like all the tours, you know, everybody kind of in my circle, they go, oh, I went to visit, I sat on the Game of Thrones. Like, do they visit the locations of your series yet?
They do. Yeah. There's a bit of that going on. We don't have like an official studio tour yet. It's funny because we shoot at Leavesden, which is the Warner Brothers studio here in London, which has the Harry Potter tour, which is sold out every day and has been for 12 years. It's crazy. Wow. And I just keep saying to them, guys, we're missing. We have to do this for us. So we don't have that, but they in Spain and North Wales and Cornwall, we've become a kind of nuisance because all these little like backwaters get overrun by fans who are looking to take selfies.
All right. Now I hear you're into Porsches. Is that
I am.
Is that why you want it? Because it makes no sense why you're on this show.
Yes, I'm not a comedy guy. No, but
usually we're talking to car people about cars, and you came in out of the dark and said, hey, would you like Ryan on the show? And I said, well, yeah, just based on the series, sure, but he likes Porsches as well. What's going on with you?
Well, thanks. Yeah, I'm a fan of the podcast. I listen very regularly. And I started, I think I found you guys right around when you started, because I was just looking for like a good kind of daily or weekly car news podcast. And I was obsessed with Porsche, and I was getting very close to like, okay, I'm going to take the plunge and buy my own. And then the irony of this job is like, I finally got the job, and then it meant that I could have one, but they moved me to the moon. Yep. And I'm not buying a right-hand drive. I refuse to do it here. So, when I get back to the US, I'm going.
Could you drive a left-hand drive there? Could you get one and still drive?
You could. And I'm actually, because I've been driving, I love cars. I'm a car guy. I've been a car guy for
and what,
my,
so know. What 911 are you interested in?
I mean, I love them all. I think I'm obsessed with the history of it. I think my ideal garage one day, maybe when I get back to the US in a couple of years, would be very simply just a 73 RS and a modern GT3. And that would be my kind of, and then I would have garage. some kind of daily driver or something to pick up the groceries.
No, you would daily drive both of those. Have you ever owned a Porsche before?
No, my brother had a 991 Carrera S that I borrowed all the time. He would go out of town. He's also in production, so he'd disappear for a month at a time, right. And I would steal his car. And then I've done the Porsche Drive program. I'm coming back to LA for a month this summer, so I'm doing that again.
Oh, you are?
Yeah. So
which program are you going to do?
The 911. I mean, I was just going to have the either a Carrera or a Carrera convertible.
They have a GT3 program there, and I believe there's a GT3 RS program there as well.
I did not know
that. I'm going to help you spend all your money.
Okay, please.
It will be worth it. You want to do the program that has the biggest weapon in it. And I also saw the Dakar there. I was there a couple weekends ago, and they had two Dakars that were being taken around. But there were GT3 RSs on the track. That is what you need to do. This is my recommendation for you.
I did the GT3 experience in LA. I actually did the Porsche Experience Center here in Silverstone, which is the famous tracks north of London. Actually, mm-hmm. I didn't realize it when I went there. It was the first one. Mm-hmm. The first one was here in England. So they've been open for almost 20 years. So we did Carreras, but that was crazy because you go around the track in the wrong direction, which throws your brain
That's
for a little
weird.
Bit.
Yeah, all of that is weird and backwards. But okay, I have a plan for you. Just like you called up George Martin, here's what I want you to do.
Okay.
I want you to call your agent and say, I want to have lunch with Chris Harris.
Okay.
I want to have lunch with Chris Harris. And you want to go to this lunch and you want to talk because you should not deprive yourself of driving when you're in England right now. You need to find something and you need to have fun and you need to know two guys, Chris Harris and Sam Fain from Seen Through Glass.
Okay.
These are our two British over the seas Porsche brothers that can tell you everything you need to know about Porsche while you're in London, all the cars and coffee, but more importantly, the roads without speed cameras so that you can enjoy a nice drive now and again, because you're going to need that to decompress. You're working too hard. I can tell.
Thank you.
You're going to be all burned out. So
I got flashed so many times, Spike. It's been all the speed limits here went down to 20 about a year ago. And try driving a modern car at 20 miles an hour consistently.
It's not right. Well, that's why you're going to talk to Chris and Sam. They're going to take care of you.
Okay.
Anyway, the new season is premiering on Max June 16th. I'm so excited. Thank God, Ryan. I'm out of stuff to watch. Do you know how excited I am about this?
Thank you.
You know, and I think you know that because you're a fan of things, judging by your collection. But there is a hungry audience out there for you, and I can tell you are you're a good shepherd. You're going to take care of us with this new season, and I couldn't be more excited about it, and couldn't be more excited about meeting you. And congratulations on all your success, man. And when you're here, you know, come see us. We'll take you for a drive, a free one.
Great. I would love that.
Not a Porsche Experience Center one. We'll put
Thank you.
I'll show you why you can daily drive that GT3 and that 73 RS. Because life is short, Ryan. Drive it like you hate it. Beat on it. Enjoy it. We're not going to be here for a long time.
Thank you, Spike. I love that.
It's very nice to meet you.
You too.
Spike's Car Radio.
And there you go.
Sweet. I've been meaning, I want to rewatch season one before season two comes out. I because I know I watched it, and it's just like, you know, during the pandemic, I watched 80 million shows a minute.
Yeah.
So I remember really enjoying it. So I want to watch it again.
Here's what Eric and I asked him about it, and he gave a satisfactory answer. But the actress who played Renera in the first three episodes, Millie Alcock,
yes,
is her name. Zuckerman's not here to chuckle at that. Good. Hey, did you hear me? Shut up.
How many cocks? All cock.
She is, Erica and I, you know, Erica was an actor too. Both of us were sitting and going, this girl is a star. She's an unbelievable star.
Yeah, yeah.
It's an incredible story arc to watch this teenage girl who's potentially going to be the heir to the throne. Her father's dying, and what a story. And then they do a jump cut in time. And then Renera, you know, played by an equally great actress.
Yeah, yep.
But still, I felt like I was robbed of a whole season of something cool. But he explained it to me that, you know, and you heard it just in the interview there. They had cast the back end of it first. And
sure.
And that's
and they got lucky with a good child actor, yeah.
They got lucky with the whole cast.
Yeah.
With the whole cast.
Oh, I mean, dude, yeah. It's, yeah, it's great.
It's shocking,
it's
but.
Good. It's good. This is one where I'm totally lost on the names. I got to go back and watch it just to get the names down. Original Game of Thrones, I got them, you know, Cersei.
I panicked, completely panicked, because I can't keep track of the names or the places or sometimes the story when I'm watching it. And my viewing partner gets angry at me.
Oh.
So you're not paying attention? This is Westeros, and the reason that...
See, I got the original Game of Thrones, I got it all. I got the
wow.
the Red Keep. I got, you know, Starks are up in...
yeah, sometimes I'm always like, wait, what? But why does he care about the White Wolf or whatever it is? Who's Richard Madden? What is he now? What is he doing? And why doesn't he care? And
The Onion Knight, anyway.
But I can still enjoy it as much... as anybody else. I just may not be able to follow it as easily.
I can't wait. So
it's one of the few shows actually that I cannot follow for some reason. I don't know why that is.
The original, the first three books are literally fantastic. Fourth book, fifth book, meh. But the first three books are some of the best reading you'll ever do. And they nailed it with the show. So,
well, the premiere of season two is June 16th, 2024. I can't say it enough.
Yes.
How much I love these shows, these series. This one in particular, and Ryan's going to come visit us, like he said, when he comes back here.
Sweet.
Super talented guy.
I just went to the season finale wrap shoot of Bosch Legacy season.
What the hell? Why was I not invited to that?
Sorry. But I saw our man Titus.
But,
I'm sorry. You wouldn't have gone. It was an all-night shoot. You wouldn't have gone.
It was
at an apartment complex in like... historic Filipino town.
Okay.
At 9 p.m.
I would have totally gone to that.
Okay.
Because it's not... First, it's another show that I absolutely love, that I will do anything for. We have Titus on the show all the way. He knows how I feel about him and his show.
He says hello and he wants to come back on before this one comes out.
That's fine. But if I... Yes, he can come on anytime. We love Titus. He's welcome anytime. But I would love to also go and see the rest of the folks that make this fantastic show on Amazon that I look forward to all the time.
So this is really funny. So,
and by the way, I'm reading the Bosch Lincoln Lawyer Connolly book right now.
Yeah.
I'm loving every page of it.
So they're doing the shoot. It's at an apartment complex. So there's like, you know, police tape everywhere.
Yep.
A block away, there's an actual murder that happened, and there's police tape everywhere. And so we're trying to find parking, and so it's like, wait, is that the set? The producer, the Swedish guy, he pulls into the actual crime scene, and the cop stops him, and he's like, no, this is all me.
This is my shoot.
No, he doesn't say it's my shoot. He says, this is all me. I did this. And the cop's like, what? And he's like, yeah, this is me. I'm doing, his assistant was like, that's not what he means. We're here for the other one.
That's fantastic.
It was, dude, I got to tell you, it was amazing to watch Titus work because this is a really dark season. I won't give anything away, but like something really rad happens at the end where he gets to be really mean to a person, and like watching him kind of work the dialogue each take to get like motherfucker even like harder, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was just great. And then he pops out and he's like happy go lucky, like the opposite of method acting.
That's
great. Yeah,
that's what we like.
It was rad.
We like the opposite of method acting.
Yes.
We love that, as a matter of fact. We like that.
It was cool.
I don't want to have to pretend with you after the scene is over.
No.
That you're that guy or girl.
Yeah. And I met, what else you got?
We gotta end the show. What do you have?
Oh. Well, I met the woman who's playing Renee Ballard, because Renee Ballard's in the last couple.
Is Mickey Haller in this season?
No.
They're not going to do, because in this book I'm reading, it's Mickey Haller and Bosch.
Yeah, but no, but they might do that at some point, but this is Renee Ballard in the last couple Bosch books.
Right.
She's because in the books, Bosch is like in his late 70s.
Right.
So she's the new thing. Anyways, they're doing a new season with Ballard, but I drove the 750S.
Yeah, no, I know. We talked about that in last show. It's a great car.
It's a terrific car.
It's a great car.
We
love this car.
I would like this car.
But much has been said about it already.
Oh, I missed it. I wasn't here.
No.
Yeah.
I had one a week ago.
I drove the Raptor R, the new one.
That's fantastic, too. Well, we're out of time. Save it for next week.
Whatever.
Ladies and gentlemen.
The two Zuckermans.
I wish you a fine week, wherever your feelings lie about what's happened in the world.
It's going great.
I say to you, get on your knees and pray to Holy Shrimp Jesus. If you don't know who Holy Shrimp Jesus is, that's the latest TikTok meme. It's somebody put Jesus's head on a shrimp and it went viral.
Excellent.
And we will see you next week on Spike's Car Radio.
Hey. Thanks for listening to Spike's Car Radio. Listen to new episodes every Wednesday and be sure to subscribe. Now, I'm gonna take a nap.